The next two cases have been consolidated for argument purposes, and that's Wright versus Service Employees International Union Local 503 and Zielinski versus Service Employees International Union Local 503.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. My name is Rebecca Millard. I represent the appellants, Christopher Zielinski and Jody Wright. I would like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal, if I may.
All right.
After listening to all the arguments this morning, it appears to me that AFSCME Council 31, back in the Janus case, they should have just forged Mark Janus's signature. They would have gotten more of his money if they had done that. And better still for the union, had they done so, and the courts followed the reasoning below, there would be no constitutional issue. The state can just shrug out of its constitutional duties altogether. But when it comes to states taking public employees' lawfully earned wages for union dues, the Supreme Court has always held that the employee must consent before the state takes that money. And that has been true from Abood through Janus and is still true today. Mr. Zielinski and Ms. Wright never became union members. They never consented to the state taking their wages or taking union dues out of their wages, yet the state took full union dues. The union's excuse here? A forged membership card. I would like to share my screen just very briefly, if I may, and show you a copy of the membership card that SEIU 503 used to justify deduction of dues from Mr. Zielinski. As you can see, the signature is a series of connected M's.
Screen sharing.
Thank you. The appellants seek reversal here for three reasons. First, it violates the First Amendment's prohibition on compelled speech for the state to take the employee's money for union dues for political speech purposes without the employee's consent or authorization. Second, there is state action when SEIU uses the state to forcibly take employees' money, just as there was state action in the Janus case. And third, this case presents a live controversy because Mr. Zielinski and Ms. Wright are still waiting for a refund of their dues. The state still uses the exact same procedures, and because declaratory and injunctive relief would effectively prevent recurrence. As to the first, Your Honor, the state system here gives the union sole control over who authorizes and who does not authorize union dues. And that results in people paying when they haven't consented. The system is essentially rigged against the employee. Again, Mr. Zielinski and Ms. Wright should not have had to pay anything. They never became members. But unions don't even need a forced fee scheme anymore. They have something better. A state law that puts the union in sole control. And then if anyone complains, they produce a membership card and claim the dues were authorized from the beginning, which is exactly what is happening in Oregon. Again, the result, non-member public employees are compelled to fund union political speech.
Council, with regard to the procedural claims, can you address the question of standing?
Yes, Your Honor.
Mr. Zielinski, as I read the complaint, sought prospective relief just on the First Amendment claim, correct? Not on the procedural due process claims.
Your Honor, I believe he seeks it as to both, and I believe as Mr. As we heard in the Wagner case, there are components of due process in the First Amendment claim as well as under the 14th Amendment. But yes, to clarify, he does want to seek a declaratory and injunctive relief as to both. I don't have the complaint in front of me, but I can certainly pull it up if that would be helpful.
All right. On the Jody Wright matter, Jody Wright retired and sued after retirement?
Yes, Your Honor. The dues stopped for Ms. Wright because she did retire from working at the state. However, we would contend that she still has a live case in controversy because the state procedures remain in effect. If she took a job at the state tomorrow, which she has every right to do, and the union pulled the state to take dues from Ms. Wright, the state would be bound by the law to do so.
Why isn't that too speculative? Why isn't that too speculative? Do we know whether she's going to be employed by the state again imminently?
No, and I would submit that it's not necessary that she plead that she is or isn't going to be. The prospective relief she requests is with regard to this procedure only. This procedure is not constitutionally adequate. And so her request for prospective relief remains as to that. And she still has a valid and viable claim for damages as well, for both compensatory and nominal damages as well. And I understand that perhaps her claim is not as strong as Mr. Zielinski, who continues to be employed by the state. But I would contend that when you look at mootness, just the fact that, you know, her circumstances changed, she ended up retiring, got out of paying union dues because she chose to do that, doesn't take away her right, doesn't take away the fact that her constitutional rights have been violated and will be violated should she again choose to take on state employment. If I may turn to state action, Your Honors, this case involves the same state action as was at issue in Janus. The Seventh Circuit pointed this out on remand of the Janus case, and saying that for state action, it is sufficient that the state deduct fair share fees from the employee's paychecks and transfer that money to the union. And the same is true here. That is what's going on. It is undisputed the state acts pursuant to state law, Oregon Revised Statute 243.806, also acts pursuant to the collective bargaining agreement, a labor contract that is entered by both the state and the union. These things together mean that the state and the union are both acting pursuant to state law. And essentially, what the union is doing here is an end run around Janus. Mr. Zielinski and Ms. Wright never joined the union, just like Mark Janus never joined the union. Yet the state attempts...
Ms. Millard, what is the constitutional harm that you're alleging?
It's compelled speech, Your Honor. These people are compelled to pay money for political purposes against their wishes and against their sincerely held beliefs. In addition to just union dues, SEIU 503 also charges a specifically designated political fund fee on top of that, which is also taken as pled in Ms. Wright's case. So there's absolutely no question that the dues that are being charged, in addition to the assessments being charged by 503, they are being used for political purposes. This is compelled speech under the Janus case, Your Honor.
But the harm was caused by the forgery, wasn't it, or the alleged forgery?
Well, Your Honor, had there just been a forgery, there would have been no damage to these plaintiffs at all. The union could forge as many membership cards as it wants, no damage. But as soon as the state takes that card and enforces it and says, I'm going to take your money pursuant to a procedure set up by the state, by state statute, then there's a harm. So there wouldn't have been any harm whatsoever from just the forgery. So I would say that the source of the harm is absolutely the state procedure at issue here. If, by analogy, if I may, the state may use a private physician to treat an inmate in prison. This is the West case. Can the state then claim that since the physician is a private party, the state has no responsibility to ensure that the Eighth Amendment is respected? No, it cannot shrug off its constitutional duty to protect the inmate's Eighth Amendment rights. And the state of Oregon cannot shrug off its constitutional duty to protect the First Amendment rights and the due process rights of public employees. I think I basically covered the issues I was intending, and if I may reserve the remainder, unless there's any questions.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor.
May it please the court, I'm Scott Cronland for the union. If what the plaintiffs in the Zielinski and Wright case allege is true, and it's not, they unquestionably have remedies against the union for violating Oregon state law, but they don't also have a Section 1983 claim against the union because the union's alleged misconduct is not state action. The court essentially decided the state action issue in Belgel already when it held that allegations that a union had failed to secure proper consent on dues authorizations didn't state a Section 1983 claim against the union. The absence of state action is even clearer here because the alleged conduct by the union is not tolerated by state law, as in Belgel. Rather, it's squarely prohibited and indeed criminalized by state law, It's the exact type of conduct that Lugar said didn't make a private party a state actor. And on prong two of the state action test, the analysis is exactly the same as in Belgao. The state is performing a ministerial role in making deductions.
So there's nothing stopping Ms. Wright or Mr. Zielinski from suing the union in state court over wrongful taking of their money.
That's correct, Your Honor. And in fact, the state has a specialized administrative agency, the Employment Relations Board, that exists to hear claims against unions for alleged problems with membership cards. They unquestionably have state remedies. And in fact,
is one of the remedies reimbursement or, you know, payment of wrongfully withheld dues or?
Yes, the Employment Relations Board can award repayment of the money. It can award prospective relief. It can award penalties, and it can require the union to pay representation fees if there was a violation. The conclusion that the union isn't a state actor is sufficient to resolve these two cases, because the plaintiffs don't have standing to seek prospective relief. The deductions for both of them had stopped before they filed suit, and because the state defendants aren't liable for retrospective relief. But I do want to respond to the narrative that there's a problem that the federal courts need to resolve. There have been allegations in several cases that unions have engaged in forgery of membership cards. There have been no findings that any of those allegations are true. There is no history of problems with union forgery of public employee membership cards. It's not like Medicaid fraud, where the state is dispersing billions and billions of dollars to private companies, and there actually is a history of fraud. And the state has an excellent system for preventing any kind of systemic problem, which is it shows every deduction on every paycheck. Any kind of systemic problem would be quickly detected. People would go to jail if they're really intentionally forging signatures. There's a specialized administrative agency to handle complaints. The states can hear tort suits. The collective bargaining agreement allows the state to request copies of the cards. There's no allegation here that the government knew or should have known that there is a problem. And hence, it doesn't make sense to talk about some kind of need for a process on the front end. The government doesn't have an obligation to have a process to prevent the deprivation when it neither knows nor should know that a deprivation is occurring. That's the Hudson v. Palmer, Perot v. Taylor line of cases. Additionally, there was an analogy in the first case on the calendar to the Supreme Court's decision in Chicago Teachers v. Hudson. The premise of Hudson was that the state had a policy that was impinging on First Amendment rights. Therefore, the state needed procedures to minimize the impingement. But unlike agency fees, the voluntary deduction of dues is not an impingement on First Amendment rights. It's simply processing people's own requests. The union's role is essentially clerical. It's supposed to provide an accurate list to the government of the people who have actually authorized deductions. If the union provides an accurate list, no deprivation could be caused by the union. It's not like prejudgment attachment or prejudgment garnishment.
Mr. Cronin, let me take you back to state action for just a moment and standing. So can these cases be resolved on standing, which is a jurisdictional issue for us?
The claims for prospective relief can be resolved on standing. They have live claims for retrospective relief against the union under 1983
in both
that failed for lack of state action.
Okay, so in both cases, the prospective relief can be resolved on standing at the jurisdictional issue. And then state action would kick in for the remaining claims.
Yes, that's...
Let me ask you this. Is state action a jurisdictional question?
No, state action is not
an element of the. It's an element of 1983, correct?
That's exactly right, Your Honor.
Okay.
But they don't have claims for retrospective relief against the only potential state actor, which is the government, because the government is immune from liability for retrospective relief. Unless the court has questions for me, I will leave the rest of my time to the Attorney General.
All right.
Thank you. May it please the court and counsel, Christopher Perdue on behalf of the state of Oregon. The state agrees fully with the union in its arguments on the merits. A further reason for affirmance in this case is that plaintiff's claims for prospective relief are non-justiciable. Neither plaintiff had standing when they made those claims, and in any event, both claims are now moot. The plaintiffs lack standing because the dues deductions had ceased before they filed their complaints in this case, and therefore they had no concrete particularized injury beyond an abstract interest in procedures or declarations that could have no effect on their rights as they stand today. The district court could not craft any effective relief to redress any potential injury because plaintiff Zielinski's dues had ceased from being deducted anymore. And moreover, the union had flagged his name in a database and agreed to subject any future membership card to further review. Plaintiff Wright is a step farther removed from the risk of erroneous deprivation because she is retired and there's no allegation or suggestion in the briefing that she intends to return to the public workforce. For similar reasons, the case would be moot and there is no reasonable expectation of recurrence. Indeed, the state of Oregon, as counsel for the union has outlined, has ample pre-deprivation and post-deprivation procedures, not least of which is an administrative right to seek compensation for any dues that have been deducted without authorization. Unless this court has any questions for the state, we would rest on our briefs.
All right, thank you. I think you have still a little bit of rebuttal time.
Thank you, Your Honor. Under SEIU and the state's reasoning, they're relieved of liability under Section 1983, despite the fact that they're taking employees' money without consent. This conclusion is impossible to square with Janus and with the rights the Supreme Court affirmed in that case. As to the idea that somehow criminal, tort, or administrative remedies are sufficient here, they certainly are not. None of those procedures give any kind of recognition or compensation for the loss of constitutional rights. And that is the essential purpose of Section 1983 and why we're bringing a Section 1983 action on behalf of these plaintiffs. Also, it was mentioned that Palmer talks about post-deprivation remedies being adequate. I would like to point out that the Palmer case specifically says when a post-deprivation remedy is not sufficient where the property deprivation is effected pursuant to an established state procedure. Again, that's exactly what is occurring here. This is an established state procedure that is resulting in the harm. There have been now, by my count, over 13 cases of forgery filed against unions, just in Washington, California, and Oregon alone, as well as a case out of the state of Minnesota, which is currently at the Eighth Circuit. The idea that this won't recur is absurd. The only way to prevent this from happening again is for the court to require a change in the process. And that's why Mr. Zielinski and Ms. Wright, who never consented to pay union dues, respectfully request this court to protect their First Amendment rights and to free them from this compelled speech. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for your arguments today. The matter is submitted, and I think that concludes. Yes, it does. It concludes our argument calendar, so we will be in recess until tomorrow morning.
All rise. Court for this session is adjourned.